Hi, I'm Apostle Tommy Bell.
I'm First Lady Tabitha Bell.
And this is Touching the World Ministries.
Oh, some more faith. I dare somebody to just worship him right there in that moment. Come on, say it. worshiping on this morning. Just gonna keep on worshiping. We're gonna keep on worshiping. How many of y'all can say that Jesus is your strength? Come on, come on, come on. How many of y'all can say the Lord is your strength? We're gonna profess that to him this morning. Like no other. vision for me. He lifted me out of darkness with his amazing grace.
Without being prepared for the battle. You can't get into without being prepared for the battle. There is a purpose for worship. He inhabits the praises of his people. Well, he wants to know that he's loved. Yes, anybody here want to know they're loved? Yes. Come on, don't you want to know every now and then that somebody loves you? Come on, come on, raise your hand. If you want to know somebody loves you, then raise your hand. I don't know who I'm talking to, but sometimes you want to know that you're loved. Come on, come on. You don't want to walk around and not know that you're loved. God just want to know that he's loved. Amen. 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 You may have your seats if you care. And welcome to Touching the World Ministry, our Youth Sunday. Put your hands together for our youth. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We welcome you. We welcome you. We welcome you. Before you get fed the word, because it's our Youth Sunday, we're going to have our very own youth minister in training. All right. Amen. She's looking at me like, oh, don't say that. Deliver us a short word, and then the next voice that you hear will be none other than yours truly. Hallelujah. Won't put your hands together in the name of Jesus.
Is forgiveness.
All right.
Amen.
My subject is forgiveness is a must.
All right now.
Father God, in the name of Jesus, I ask you to cover me as I speak this message of God. Let somebody in here take something from my message of God. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen.
Amen.
We all know that forgiveness is hard to do, and we all have been down that, oh, I'm not forgiving you road. But don't even realize we are stopping our blessings and losing our ticket into heaven. Forgiveness doesn't mean what happened is okay. It's peace. But in order to receive peace, you have to come from the heart and mean those words. We all have to learn how to let go and let God. Because at the end of the day, we are hurting ourselves.
Ha! Teach!
When you don't forgive others, you are giving them the power and authority to take their joy and happiness away.
Yes! Yes!
Amen.
Forgiveness is not for them, it's for you.
Come on, right, man.
It takes a strong person to say sorry or accept apologies. I'm not saying you have to build a relationship back with that person, but you do have to do your part as a Christian and as a leader and forgive.
Amen. Yeah.
God does things for a reason. He tests his people whether if it's an easy or a hard test because God knows we are all capable of.
Mm-hmm.
God will test you and give you a testimony.
Amen.
Sometimes you have to start with yourself and forgive yourself.
Amen. That's it.
If life gets too hard to stand, kneel.
Amen.
Don't allow people's actions to define you or your character. Amen. Let the pain strengthen you. God said, forgive, and you will be forgiven.
Amen.
And in my closing, God's plan is always the best. Only God can turn a mess into a message.
Yes. That's right.
A test into a testimony.
That's right.
And a trial into a triumph.
Amen.
Sometimes the process is painful and hard, but don't forget, when God is silent, he does something for you.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Forgiveness. Anybody here needs to learn how to be a forgiving type of a person. It's not easy to forgive. Because you keep thinking about what they did to you. So like she said, it takes a strong person. It takes a strong person to forgive. Amen. Amen. It takes a strong person to forgive. Because you stay thinking about what they did to you. And you like, why should I forget? I didn't even do nothing. I was minding my own business. Bishop, you looking at the person like, I don't really want to forgive you. I really don't like you. This is what you did to me. But God said, without forgiveness, you gonna hurt. Trying to help somebody. Amen. Come on, one more time. Put your hands together for our minister in training, Vanessa Kirsch. Amen. 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 So glad to be here this morning, and I want to thank Bishop and Lady Tabitha for giving me this opportunity to speak to the people. Amen. Put your hands together for our Bishop. He's a man of God. He's a man of God. He's a man of God. Ain't no fakeness in this. Come on now. Come on. You could be anywhere else with another pastor. You'll be like, what's wrong with that pastor? But you at Touching the World Ministry, and you know you going home saying, boy, Bishop got some good word. Come on, you ever went to a restaurant, you got some good food, and you like, oh, I got some good food. What time they open back up tomorrow? I just want to get a little bit more. That's how you leave when you leave Touch the World. As the bishop of the faith, you like, God, no. There's some good food. I just need some walkthroughs. So, oh, well, I can't wait till next Sunday. Next Sunday, I'm going to get some walkthroughs. I'm going to get some juice in this city. Bishop, he's feeding us, homie. You better know. With that TV show, make you want to slap your mama. Bishop will be feeding us, and you only be hungry when you leave here.
Amen.
So if this is your first time here, I guarantee you, don't worry about me, I might not feed you good. Amen. But come back next week. All right, amen, 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 amen. I just got an appetizer. I feel good. Just come on back next week. Don't let me mess up your spirit. I don't know what God want to do, but look, I ain't the pastor, so I don't want to mess nobody up. If you do here, just come back next week. Amen. Some of y'all looking at your watch saying, I hope he's about 10 minutes. I don't want to mess nobody up. Just come back next week, and Bishop will take care of you. Hallelujah. Yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. I feel good. I wish I could sing. I would sing before I started. But see, I would give thanks to my wife for being here and supporting me. So as I look at her when I say, I love that woman right there, I know she's going to look at me saying, boy, you better not sing nothing. Boy, I love her. If I can sing. Let me see.
Oh, my God.
This ain't no ordinary world. This ain't no ordinary song. Yeah. God tells us greater than the ordinary. So I'm gonna give him all I have in this world. This ain't no
if I can.
Samuel chapter 18, we're going to begin at verse 6.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Look, you know I'm getting old. Don't laugh at me. I got to put some glasses on now. I've accepted who I am. I've accepted who I am. 18 years ago when I preached my initial sermon, I didn't need glasses. DJ, I didn't need glasses. Now, 18 years later, I'm not going to try to even do this without these glasses. Amen, amen. But I was smart about it. I got the, what do you call it, the bifocal, the no lens, yeah. So I can still see you.
I guess.
I can see this too. First Samuel, chapter 18, verses 6 through 9. I would love for everybody to be standing for God's word to show him his reverence. Amen. If you haven't say amen, if you need some more time, say hold up, wait a minute, let me turn some more pages. All right, amen, amen. 1 Samuel 18. It says, when the victorious Israelite army, and I'm reading from the New Living Translation, was returning home after David had killed the Philistine, women from all over the towns of Israel came out to meet King Saul. They sang and danced for joy with tambourines and cymbals. And this was their song. Wish we had a beat today. I tried to make a beat. I couldn't do it. It says, Saul has killed thousands, and David his 10,000s. This made Saul very angry. What's this? Saul said, can you picture his face? What's this? He said, they credit David with 10,000s and me with only 1,000s. Next, they'll be making him their king. So from that time on, Saul kept a jealous eye on David. Let us pray. Father God, in the name of Jesus, I ask that you come forth as you already have done, Lord. Lord, leave your angels here, Lord, that I may be able to speak with you in mind, Lord. Let the people have the ears they need to hear your word, Lord. Let them not see me, let them not be with me, Lord, but let them hear you, see you, and be with you, Lord. We ask these things in the Master's name of Jesus, and the church says amen,
amen.
And amen. You may take your seat. Hallelujah. We've had some good church here, right? Amen. God is good. God is good. So I want to talk to you this morning from the aspect of verse 9, where it declares in the Bible, and it says, from the time Saul got angry, he kept a jealous eye on David. Somebody say jealous eye.
Jealous eye.
The subject for this sermon is titled, I Can't Die with Jealousy in My Heart. Say it again for somebody that needs to hear it. I can't die with jealousy in my heart. For those that may be not hearing well, I'm going to say it one more time. I'm going to say it slower. I cannot die with jealousy in my heart. As a subtitle, as I like to use subtitles, a subtitle, when I'm looking at Saul, when I thought about the subtitle, when God gave title, I looked at the words and God gave me the subtitle, haters gonna hate.
Haters
gonna hate. Come on, look at your neighbor and tell your neighbor, say, haters gonna hate. Now, that was good. That was the wrong neighbor, because see, they have not seen your car. Look at the other neighbor and tell that neighbor, haters gonna hate. That was good, but the other neighbor ain't seen your house. Come on, look at somebody else. to tell them, haters gonna hate. That was all right, but there's somebody that don't know the degree that you have on your wall. Yell out, say, haters gonna hate. Come on, they're looking at your hair, they're looking at your nails, they're looking at your toes, they're looking at your Louis Vuitton bag. Say it again, haters are gonna hate. They're looking at your weed, they're looking at the sewing, they're wondering, how did you get all that? I'm just not sure how you got the sewing to look so perfect. It looks good on your head. Somebody say it again, haters gonna hate. But when they hate, you just tell them I was grinding and I was making the money I needed. But so you can hate on me, but you don't know that I was on my knees that night. You can hate all you want, but you don't know the time I put into my marriage. You can hate all you want, but you don't know the hours I spent behind the computer working on that degree. You can hate all you want, but you don't know what God has done for me. Haters gonna hate. Come on, say it again. Haters gonna hate. At the baby girl that didn't finish that MSU, and you looking at the baby girl that finished at JSU, and you looking at the baby girl that might have been right now at USM, and you looking at the baby boy that's a gifted, but I'm telling you right now, you don't know what I done put in to get where I'm at. If you want to get what I got, you gotta do what I did. You gotta get on your knees at night, you gotta pray, you gotta ask God for forgiveness, you gotta do what you gotta do. Because you can't be no hater. Haters gonna hate. And I dare somebody not to hate but congratulate. I dare you not to hate but congratulate. As soon as you start congratulating and not hating, God can do for you what He did for them. I'm getting ahead of myself. Saul, watch this. Saul had it all. The Bible said that Saul was the son of Kish. Mm-hmm. He was a wealthy man. Uh-huh. He was an influential man. And he was a member of the tribe of Benjamin. Uh-huh. The Bible says that he looked healthy and wealthy. He said the Bible says that Saul was a tall, handsome, and groomed man. Uh-huh. Say your word, you gotta read it. He was taller than any other people in his tribe. Uh-huh. And at age 30, watch this, mm-hmm. Saul... watch this. Saul was selected to be king. He was hand-selected by God himself at age 30. That tells me that what God has for you, it is for you. Ain't too many kings going to be selected at 30, but Saul did it at age 30. Tall, handsome, dark, and you just look debonair. He stood amongst everybody else. And at age 30, God said, I want Saul to be the king of my people.
Yes.
Saul was married. He had five children. The Bible somewhere says he had six. But Saul was married. He had five children. He had three boys, and he had two girls. Don't we all want that white picket fence? The wife, the husband, the kids, the dog, the car. Saul was already married, and he had five children. Saul had it all. He was chosen by God to be the first king of Israel. And look, watch this. He defeated the Ammonites, he defeated the Philistines, he defeated the Moabites, and he also defeated the Amalekites. Saul had it all. He was courageous in battle. He was admired and respected by all the people, and he reigned as king for over 42 years. But Saul, watch this. Even though Saul had it all, watch this. Saul was a hater. I'm going to help somebody this morning. I'm not sure who I'm talking to. But even though he had it all, Saul was a hater. It took three letters. It took three letters to tick Saul off. It took three letters just to tick with all that he had, or with all that God had given him. It took one word to send Saul into a rage of jealousy. T-E-N. 10. That's all it took. That's all it took. That's all it took was 10. Tell somebody I can't die. Jealousy in my heart. verse 7. Verse 7 is where it says it. It says, said the women came out after David and the men of Israel destroyed the Philistines, and they sang a song. You know how, can you imagine it? The victory is completed, and the women came out, and they had a little party going on, and a celebration came on, and Saul's over there, and David's over there, and the men are coming around, and they're talking, having their little stories. You see how I cut his head off? Yeah. You see how I stabbed that one? Oh, I did it. And everybody's running around saying, boy, you did that thing. Boy, that was good. And the women playing the tambourines, they having a party, and they just hopping around, and they just oranges on the floor, and water on the floor. They got Apple, they got Pizza Hut, they got Domino's. They having a celebration. And then they start singing a song. And they say, hey, you know, Saul's over there listening. He's looking, but he's king, so he's just paying attention. And David's over there, and he's just looking and saying, yeah, I get it. Because, you know, David was a kid. And David's like, yeah, that was pretty good. And all of a sudden, the women started singing that song. And they said, Saul killed thousands. I can imagine that when they said it, Saul said, because it was probably a pause in the song. And Saul was over there, and Saul said, they said, oh, Saul killed thousands. And Saul said, yes, I did. And then all of a sudden, the song kept going, and they said, but David killed say, yeah, I did that. And Saul, from that point on, one word.
Wow.
One word. Whoa. Ten. Ten. One word changed everything.
Wow.
Sometimes we get hung up.
Wow.
On the wrong word.
Yeah.
Come on.
Sometimes I'm not sure who I'm talking to, but sometimes you get tangled with hearing the wrong word. Sometimes we get distracted when we hear a word that's not even supposed to mean anything to us in our lives. Sometimes we hear the word and it affects our spirit. Understand, my brothers and my sisters, that's the trick of the enemy. I'm not sure who needs to hear that, but somebody on that job was confused last week because you heard a word that you wasn't even meant to hear, but you heard it and it distracted you for the rest of the week. Well, they're gonna help me in here. The only word you need to be focused on is the word of God. The word that I have hidden in my heart that I might not sin against you. The only word you need to be focused on is the word of God. Weeping may endure, even when you're going through, weeping may endure for a night, but the only word you need to be focused on is after I suffer for a while, God's gonna prevail. The only word that you need to be, the only word, great though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, the only word you need to be focused on is the word of God. And start listening to God, you wouldn't have as many problems as you have now. Don't you know that gossip is just nothing but an evil thing that the enemy sent down to mess you up? He wants you to be distracted. He wants you to be confused. But I'm here to tell you this morning that you need to stop listening to what they're saying and start listening to what God is saying. Your opportunity.
Jesus.
Saul was focused on the wrong word. Listen to all them crazy folks. Hate is gonna hate.
Yeah.
Get mad up here.
Yeah.
Saul was focused on the wrong word, and that's what led him to jealousy. With all that he had been given by God, with all that God did for him, he got hung up on one word, 10,000. Look, it's not even like they said Saul didn't kill nobody. They said Saul killed thousands. So he got credit for
what?
You won't get credit for what you do, but you can't be jealous about what somebody else did. I don't know who I'm talking to. I'm not sure. You gotta guard your ear gate. You gotta guard what they say. You gotta guard your mind. You gotta put up a hedge of protection around your ears. Because sometimes what you hear can mess you up. Let me help you. Let me give you three things that might prevent you from dying with jealousy in your heart. I'm going to give you three things that could prevent you, that could help you not die with jealousy in your heart.
Glory to God.
Number one, in order to avoid death, of jealousy. You must first walk in a spirit of humbleness. I'm gonna let that simmer, I'm gonna let that marinate in somebody's spirit. I want you to get it. In order for you to possibly not die with a death of jealousy, you gotta get a spirit of humbleness. God said when you are humble, you are free from pride and arrogance. The word says, everyone who exalts himself will be humbled. But he who humbles himself will be exalted. You got to learn how to walk in the spirit of humbleness, y'all. Y'all not going to say nothing. You got to learn how to walk in the spirit of humbleness. Just because you got that job don't mean you got to gloat. Just because you retired from the military with 26 years, you got all that money, you ain't got to gloat. You got to learn how to walk in the spirit of humbleness. Just because you got married and you found your husband, you found your wife, you ain't got to gloat. You got to learn how to walk in the spirit of humbleness. Just because you're a doctor, just because you're a lawyer, humbleness. Just because you can sing, you gotta still learn how to walk in the spirit of humbleness. Just because you can dance, you gotta learn how to walk in the spirit of humbleness. I'm talking to you right now. Just because you can dance, just because you can sing, just because you got a six-figure job, you gotta learn how to walk in the spirit of humbleness. Just because you know how to preach, you gotta learn how to walk in the spirit of humbleness. Just because you know how to pray, you gotta learn how to walk in the spirit of humbleness. You used to go paycheck to paycheck. You used to go paycheck to paycheck. You used to rob Peter to pay Paul. You used to borrow money from somebody to borrow money from, just so you can pay your bills, just so your lights can be turned on. But as soon as you got a job, you walk around saying, "What's wrong with them? I don't understand why they can't pay their bills. What is their problem? I just don't understand it." You used to walk around in clothes that was this short, but now that you got a little bit of sanctification in you, you got dressed that look, and you walk around looking at your, "What's wrong with them? Why that dress is so short? I don't know why that hair ain't combed. What's wrong with their kids?" You gotta learn how to walk in a spirit of humbleness.
Thank you, Lord.
You gotta understand that what you got, God gave you. Everything you got, God gave you. You got a car, God gave you. You got a house, God gave you. You got a wife, God gave you. You got a husband, God gave you. You got a job, God gave you. You got money, God gave you. You got talent, God gave you. You ain't did nothing by yourself. I'm gonna say it again, I'm gonna try to use my emotes. You ain't did nothing by yourself. I'm gonna say it again from this side. You ain't did nothing by yourself. I'm gonna say it for the middle room. You ain't did nothing by yourself. Y'all from New York, and I'm gonna go this side right here. Watch this. He was only appointed because he was humble, and that's why God selected him. But as soon as he saw David, the overnight success, he lost his humility and began to be jealous. He forgot what it took to get there. He forgot all about being humble. He started to be jealous and said, I don't know why he got all that, but he had everything. Forgot what it was like to be thankful. He forgot to enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his court with praise. He forgot that everything that he had that God did. Jealousy can take you further than you want to go and keep you there longer than you want to stay. I'm going to but say it again for somebody. If you got jealousy in your heart, it'll take you exactly where you don't want to go, and it'll leave you there longer than you want to stay. Jealousy will mess you up. You'll be so engulfed with what they got that you forget that what you got. You'll be so engulfed with how they got it that you'll forget that God gave it to you. Jealousy will mess you up. I refuse to die with jealousy in my heart. The first thing you gotta do is have a spirit of humbleness. Number two, after you become humble, you realize that everything you have, God did, and you gotta begin to accept. Part two of the blueprint you need to survive jealousy is you need to have acceptance. In order to be humble, you gotta accept what God has done for you and what God has not done for you. Because a lot of the things that God has not done for us is because we don't need it. A lot of the things that God has not done for us is because we can't handle it. A lot of the things that God has done for us or has not done for us is because we don't deserve it. It's not to say you won't get everything, but you got to understand that God has the wisdom to know that you can't handle the six-figure job. Show who I'm talking to? Acceptance precedes change. I'll say it again. Acceptance precedes change. You can't change anything that you don't take ownership of. I'll say it again. You cannot accept anything and change anything that you don't have take ownership of. If you do something wrong, you gotta accept that I'm wrong. If you do something wrong, the first thing you gotta do is say, I'm sorry, that's humility, and then say, I accept my wrongdoing.
Yeah.
Bump this somebody and tell them that acceptance precedes change.
Yeah.
And watch this. Denial precedes destruction.
Yeah.
Say it again. Denial precedes destruction.
Yeah.
If you keep on denying what's going on in your life, you will be destroyed. God will tap you on the shoulder and say, I'm trying to get you straight. I'm trying to get you straight, but you're not listening. He gonna tap you on the shoulder and listen. I'm trying to get you straight. And you just looking around saying, ain't nothing wrong with me. Ain't nothing wrong with me. Ain't nothing wrong with God. God gonna tap you on the shoulder. I'm trying to get you straight. Ain't nothing wrong with me. Ain't nothing wrong with me, but God will keep tapping. Denial precedes destruction. Saul lived in denial. Look at verse 12. It says, Saul was afraid knowing the Lord was with David because he saw David kill Goliath. He saw it with his own two eyes. He saw a boy kill a giant, but he couldn't accept that that was God's plan. Let me help somebody. His ways are not your ways. You gotta come into a point where you accept everything that God is doing for you in your life. Nothing just happens. I'm telling you right now. If it did happen, it was by God. If it didn't happen, it was by God. Nothing just happens. You gotta learn how to accept it because his ways are not your ways. You can't outthink him. You can't outdo him. You can't outrun him. You can't outtalk him. You can't outmesmerize him. There's nothing you can do that will give God amazement, but there's everything you can do that will amaze God when you accept his will.
Yeah.
All you got to do is accept it.
Yeah.
And look, watch this. Once you begin to accept the will of God, your perception will change.
Yeah.
I'm gonna say it again. Once you accept the will of God, your perception will change. The circumstances won't change. Everything that's going on around you is not going to change, but because you accepted the will of God, your perception, well, he's not that bad of a husband. I'm really not why I feel this way, but she is all right as a wife. I don't know, my job is okay anyway. I don't know. I accepted God's will. He gave me this job in the first place, so here I am. Let me just change. God, this is your will. So all of a sudden, I'm walking on the job, and everything is all right.
All right.
All of a sudden, I'm walking in the house, and everything is all right. The circumstance, you didn't change wives. You didn't change husbands. You didn't change jobs. You didn't change addresses. You didn't change nothing. All you did was just say, I accept the will of God, and everything has changed.
Amen.
Praise God. As soon as you begin accepting the will of God, everything in your life will change. You don't believe me? Watch this. When you accept the will of God, you will have the power to kill a lion in January. I'm just trying to tell somebody. As soon as you accept the will of God, you will have the tenacity to destroy a bear in June. Yes. Somebody read their Bible. As soon as you accept the will of God, you will have all that you need to destroy a Goliath in December. Well, I don't know, somebody that went over somebody's head, that went over somebody. David killed a lion, a bear, and a giant, all because he accepted the will of God. You gotta learn how to accept the will of God. You can't stand there with your mouth turned up and your nose plucked up and say, I don't know why he got all that. I don't know why she got all that. I just need to, I don't even know what's wrong with her. You need to accept the will of God for your life and understand that the only reason that you got what you got is because of God. And as soon as you start accepting what God has done in your life, everything in your life will get better. Accept this. You got flaws, I got flaws, she got flaws, we got flaws. If you ain't got a flaw, raise your hand. Don't raise your hand, we're going to be in trouble. If you think you're perfect, raise your hand. Don't raise your hand, we're going to be in trouble. We all got flaws, but it's time for you to accept your flaws and have ownership over what you done did wrong. You can't keep going around saying, my mama wasn't there when I was growing up. You can't keep going around saying, my daddy wasn't there when I was growing up. I don't know why I'm sad. You can't keep going around and saying, I don't know, I wasn't loved as a child. I don't know why this is. You gotta accept everything. You can't walk around. I don't know why I got this job. I don't know why they hired me on this job. You gotta accept everything that's going on in your life in order to be. I don't know why my car keep breaking down. Maybe you ain't paying your tithes. I don't know. You gotta accept the will of God over your life. Before you can move forward in your life. Have a seat. I'm gonna give you the last point and get out your way. Okay, the last piece of this three piece, okay? To make sure that you do not die with jealousy in your heart. Number one, you gotta be humble. Number two, you have to accept God's will. The last piece, this is the most important one. I might blow your mind. If you need a pencil, if you need a pen, whatever you need, turn a recorder on, whatever you need to do, do what you got to do, because the last piece, you can't forget this last piece, you can't miss it. The last piece you need to make sure that you don't die with jealousy in your heart is you got to be obedient. I'm going to sit down right here in the spirit. I'm going to sit down. I'm going to let them get this. Because somebody, when you say be obedient, you got somebody say, I'm not obedient. I just do what I need to do. I don't know why God always tells me. I'm going to sit down right there. But you must be obedient to what God has called you to do and what God has told you to do.
Wow.
Watch this. Jealousy caused Saul to live in rage. Watch this. Rage blinds you. Watch this. Rage blinds you. And it led God to remove his hand from Saul.
Alright.
I'm gonna do this slow. But it wasn't jealousy that did it. It wasn't jealousy that did it. Saul tried to kill David 12 times. Saul tried to kill David 12 times. Two times he threw a spear at him. David was just playing the harp, minding his own business. And a spirit of torment came over Saul, and he just picked the spear up and said, now I don't like you. He threw the spear at him. Two times. He tried to kill him 12 times. David had two times to try to kill Saul, but he didn't do it. He tried to kill him 12 times. It was jealous. It was rage. But jealousy wasn't what caused God to lift his hand off of Saul. Watch this, chapter 15. God gave Saul clear instructions.
Watch this.
God said, go and completely destroy the Amalekite nation. God said, look, Saul, I need you to do me a favor. Hook this up, right? I need you to go into the nation and kill them all. Kill the men, kill the woman, kill the baby. It's in your Bible. Kill the men, kill the woman, kill the babies, kill the stock, kill the donkeys, kill the sheep. I need you to destroy everything they have. I need you to get rid of it. I don't want nothing to come back. I want it all destroyed. Pillage, fire, do whatever you got to do, Saul. Go up there and do it. I chose you to be the king. I need you to destroy everything. And Saul said, okay.
Yeah.
Watch this. Saul got 300 men, 200 from one side, 100 from the other side. And Saul said, look, we're going into the Amalekites. We're going to kill them all. We're going to destroy them all. We're going to pillage through the whole village. Men, women, boys, girls, children, stop. We're going to do it all. We're going to kill them all. And they destroyed everything.
Mm-hmm. All right.
They destroyed everything. Saul led them. He led them. And they destroyed everything but. Here's the but. That's a transitional word for those who don't know. I teach. Transitional word, you know what that means. But Saul spared the life of Agag. He was the king, and Saul spared his life. Not only did he spare his life, but he kept the best of the sheep, the best of the goats, the cattle, the calves, and the lambs. He said, I destroyed everything. But I'm going to keep you alive. You come with me. You get the lamb, get the cattle, get the donkey. Bring it with me. God ain't going to see it. God ain't going to see what I'm doing. I know God said it, but God ain't going to. Just come with me. God sees all. If you didn't know, I'm telling you right now, God sees all. I wish somebody would put their hands together with the fact that they know that God sees all. Everything you say, God is looking. God sees all. It was at that point. It was at that point when Saul did that. That in the scripture it says, God told Samuel, I regret I picked Saul. So obedience is the key. You will never get to the right destination as long as you're going in the wrong direction. I'm gonna say it again. I know somebody didn't hear me. You will never get to your the right destination as long as you keep going in the wrong direction. I don't care if you're supposed to be over there and you're going this way, you're never gonna make it over there. And you're supposed to be back there and you're going this way, you will never get to the right destination as long as you are going in the wrong direction. Watch this. You can't keep doing wrong and expect everything to be right.
But I'm going to give him a dollar. I don't know why he has a twin. I'm going to give him a dollar. And you expect your finances to be blessed?
Lord.
You expect your marriage to be good, but you go home yelling at your wife. You go home laying hands on your wife. You go home cursing your husband out. You go home tearing down your husband. You can't expect everything to be right if you're doing wrong. And every time you walk in your job, you got your nose sucked up. You got your face turned up. Somebody say good morning, you like, hey, how you doing? You can't expect everything to be right if you do it wrong. It don't work that way. If you don't pay your car bill, they're going to repossess your car. If you don't pay your mortgage, they're going to foreclose on your home. If you don't pay your light bill, they're going to turn the lights off. You cannot expect to get right when you do it wrong. It don't work that way. It just don't work that way. The Bible says that obedience is better than sacrifice. I don't know who I'm helping this morning. I don't know. But somebody needs to hear this. If you do not learn how to be obedient, your life will always be in turmoil. And the reason why it will be in turmoil is because God has already given you the instructions for success. So because you're not obedient, he told you to step out and start that business. I don't know why you're waiting. I don't know why. He told you to step out and go ahead and do what you want. I don't know why you're waiting. But until you learn how to walk in obedience, you will never be successful in your life. Come on, put your hands together to Jesus. Let me close this right now. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Let me close.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Holy Ghost. Saul,
because of his inability to live humble, because of his failure to accept God's plan, because of his weakness to be obedient. Saul, watch this. He died by his own sword.
That's it.
Bible, it's in the Bible. He had time. Go ahead and read it. It's in Samuel. He died by his own sword. Watch this. I can't die with jealousy in my heart. Can't die with that. The Bible says that Saul died by his own sword. But I'm going to translate that for you. I'm going to translate it, and I'm going to be done. I'm going to give you the translation, and I'm going to be done. He died by his own sword. Watch this. In translation, what it's saying is Saul died by his own. In the middle of the war, Saul died by falling on his sword. Watch this. What it's really saying. Everything you have in your possession can either kill you or lift you up. Somebody didn't get that. I'm going to say it again. Sometimes the things that you have in your possession can either kill you or lift you up. I don't know who I'm talking to. What you have in your possession can either bring you down or lift you up. What you have in your possession can cause you to live or cause you to die. Now, so everything you have in your possession is either going to take you to the right or take you to the left. Now, let me tell you what you got in your possession.
That's
good. Saul had a sword. And the Bible says he died on his sword. Watch this, Bishop. He died by falling on his sword. I just told all y'all that everything you have in your possession can either kill you or lift you up. Watch this. So for those who have Jesus in their possession, for those who are walking around with the Holy Ghost, for those that have given their life to Christ, you know you have that in your possession. So you can just stand up, keep on walking, and know that what I have in my possession is going to lift me up. You ain't got to fear no more. You ain't got to be scared no more. You ain't got to cry no more. Because what you have on the inside, what you have on the inside will change your life. That's what Saul had. Saul had it in his possession. Anybody in here got Jesus? Anybody in here got Jesus? I just want to see the people in here that got Jesus. I wish I had some folks that had Jesus in their possession. I wish I had some folks that had Jesus in their possession. I wish I knew some folks that knew that what I have on the inside is going to change my life. If I'm humble, if I accept, and if I have obedience. If you got Jesus, raise your hands right now. Come on, put your hands together for Jesus. You already healed. You already blessed. You already delivered, and you are already set free. All because of what you already have in your possession.
Hallelujah.
What you have in your possession can turn your life around. Here's my wrap up. If you don't figure this thing out, watch this. If you don't figure this thing out, you'll be lost for a long time. If you don't figure this thing out, you'll be lost for a long time. How do I know this? Watch this. Saul reigned as king for 42 years. But he chased David around the latter part. His focus was on David. So Saul never enjoyed. If you don't get this, you're going to be lost. Saul never enjoyed the pleasures and the fruit of God because he was so focused on what David was doing that he lost on what God had. Somebody gotta get this. If he had just focused on what God gave him, he wouldn't have been lost at the time of the war. But because he was engulfed with rage at the time of the war, he fell on his sword and he lost all the privileges, all the good times of being and walking with God because he was focused on David.
My Lord.
Somebody in here this morning.
Wow.
Gotta focus on Jesus.
Oh, wow.
Somebody in here this morning gotta focus on Jesus. I want you all to stand on your feet right now. Come on, I need you to focus on Jesus. Don't focus on what they're doing. Focus on what God is doing in your life. Come on, I need you to focus on what God has done in your life. Stop worrying about what they did. There's so many haters in his life. I went to see a movie last night, and I seen a piece of it where Cat Williams talked about the new movie came out with Tiffany Haddish, and he was a hater. He'd been in the industry for years. Yeah. Cat Williams been in the industry for years. He's famous. I love him. Yeah. Curses too much, but I love him.
Right.
He is so funny.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
But he's a hater.
Hater. That's right.
He's a hater, Bishop.
Yeah.
He talked about Tiffany Haddish. He don't know her story.
Yeah.
Yeah. He don't know her story. She was in foster homes. Her mom had an accident, had brain surgery. Jesus. He don't even know her story, but he hates. And that's what we do in the body of Christ.
Yeah.
We look at the person coming through the door, and because they're looking good, we look at them and say, I don't want to see who they think they are.
My God.
We look at the happy marriage and say, oh, they happy, they probably sad at home. Why you hating? Why you hating? Aren't you blessed?
Wow.
So I tell the kids every morning. Every morning I see a kid get off the bus. Every morning I do this. Every morning I see them get on the bus and it looks like this. They looking like this.
Mm-hmm.
And you know what I would tell them?
Mm-hmm.
Why you looking like that?
Mm-hmm.
Can you move your fingers?
Yes, God.
Can you move your limbs? Aren't you walking from the bus?
Yes, God.
Is your chest not going up and down?
Yes, God.
You're breathing.
Yes.
You got all the reasons in the world to be happy.
Yes,
why you hating?
My God.
So I challenge every last one of you,
Jesus,
from this day forward,
God,
don't be like Saul.
Yes, God.
Don't have jealousy in your heart.
Yes, God.
Here's the deal. Saul picked David.
Yeah.
Saul picked David.
Yeah. We're in
that thing. David, Jesse, David's dad said, Jesse, go down there and take it, talk to Saul real quick. And David got down there and was like, hey, what y'all doing? And Saul was back there, and they say, oh, we looking at the Philistine, the giant. Oh, yeah, we're about to go fight them. And David said, what's a Philistine? What you talking about? I don't know what you're talking about. And he was a kid. He was a teenager. Jesus. And he looks at Saul and say, hey, I would like to do that. And Saul said, you can't do that. You're just a little kid. David said, yeah, I'll probably get you. Let me get trial. Saul took all of this stuff over and said, here, wear my stuff. David put it on and said, nah, this don't even fit me.
Right, right.
I can imagine Saul saying, wow, this kid got a lot of nerves. That's crazy.
Yes.
You think you can do this? Go ahead, fight that big giant. Now, let me tell you something, David. Now you ain't know the teenager.
My God.
That giant been fighting for a long time. David, you a teenager, but that giant been fighting for a long time. He been in wars and battles, and he's a big old giant. And David said, you know what? Take your stuff. Take your garbage. And these shoes don't fit me anyway. And take this jacket off. And Saul, I tell you what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna go out there and matter of fact, before I go, let me find these five stones. And they smooth too. Yeah, let me find these five stones. And I'm gonna go fight the giant. And I can imagine Saul looking at David going, man, this dude got some crazy. Out. And then I'll take you out and cut your head off. And I'm going to show it to all the people. David said it, read your Bible.
Yeah.
I'm paraphrasing it, don't matter.
Yeah.
And he took the slingshot and he laid it back and one shot.
Yeah.
Hit the lion right in the head.
Uh-huh.
Knocked him out. Walked up on top of him and took his sword.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Cut off his head.
Yeah.
And all the Philistines start running. Mm-hmm. And then all the Israelites, they all start killing him. And Saul watched it. And Saul was happy. Can you imagine?
Yeah.
Can you imagine? He was happy. But as soon as they start saying, ooh, David, go David, go David, go David, all of a sudden, Saul like, now I don't like this dude.
My God. My Lord.
I don't like this dude. You can't be be a hater, folks.
Yeah.
You can't be a hater.
Yes.
You cannot be a hater. Especially in this day and age.
Yeah.
We need to lift each other up.
That's it.
We got some crazy folks in the government. We saw them be crazy up in the church. Lift each other up. Don't be a hater. Don't be a hater. If you see something that you want, don't be a hater. How about going to them and say, hey, how did you get that? I see you've been married for 30 years. You're your husband's name right now. You're your wife. How'd you get that, Bishop?
Come on.
Can you give me some tips on how to be a pastor? Don't hate. You have such elegance about you. I love the way you take care of people. Can you teach me how to be a first lady?
Come on,
can you teach me how to be a first? Oh, your dance ministry is so cool. Can you teach me how to dance? Oh, you sing so beautiful. Oh, my God, you sing so beautiful. Oh, can you teach me how to sing? How do you sing?
I teach them.
Come on.
Stop hating.
Come on. Stop hating. So something I said, resonated in your spirit. You know that God's been talking at you the whole time. You know you got some jealousy in your heart. You got 10 brothers and sisters. You don't like the baby brother or sister because they famous. You don't like the middle brother or sister because they got everything going on. If something's tugging at your heart, you got some jealousy in your heart, the altar is open.
Hallelujah.
I want to pray for you. Permission to bishop. I want to pray for you. Come on, the altar is open.